Good afternoon, and welcome to the Bardo Art Center at Western Carolina University's virtual programming. I'm Denise Drury-Homewood, Director of the Bardo Art Center, and I'm so glad you could join us here today for our virtual public program highlighting artists from the Cultivating Collections exhibition series. Today's talk centers around one of the WCU Fine Art Museum's upcoming fall exhibitions, Cultivating Collections, Painting, Ceramics, and Latin American and Latinx Artists. This long format series of exhibitions takes place over the course of 3 years, and it began in 2019 and it will end in 2021. It examines areas of growth and highlights the collecting focus areas of the WCU Fine Art Museum. And in preparation for the Cultivating Collections series, we've acknowledged that many of the artists in the WCU Fine Art Museum's permanent collection do not represent people of color, women, and members of our LGBT community. While we do have artists in the collection, they're not equitably represented. So to begin the work to ensure that our collection reflects more equitably our student body at Western Carolina University and our regional community, we've begun to prioritize acquisitions and strategically purchase work by artists representing these communities. And they focus primarily on contemporary artists underrepresented in our museum's collection. There is a lot more work to be done that we have to do to increase diversity and equitable representation in the museum's collection. And we will work to utilize our resources and relationships to amplify the voices of traditionally marginalized people through the arts. The museum collects contemporary art of the Americas, which includes artists living in North America, Central America, and South America. And we collect works on paper, including prints, drawings, paintings, and photographs, as well as painting, sculpture, ceramics, glass, and technology-based work. And we also hold the world's largest collection of vitrograph prints. Today's discussion will be facilitated by the WCU Fine Art Museum's Curator of Collections and Exhibitions, Carolyn Grosch. About 12:30, we'll open it up to questions from our audiences watching on Facebook and YouTube. So please, throughout the comments, post your questions in the comment section of Facebook and YouTube, and we'll get to as many questions as possible. We're making this event possible behind the scenes. Primarily Sam Wallace, WCU's Director of Photography and Videography Services, who is facilitating the video feed, and Bardo Art Center's own Jill Jacobs, who is fielding questions from YouTube and Facebook. I also want to recognize two generous donors to the museum's collection, Ray Griffin and Tom Robinson, who have contributed a number of works to the WCU Fine Art Museum's permanent collection over the years, including the works that will be discussed today. So we're joined here by two artists who created collaborative work that's in the permanent collection and will be featured in the upcoming Cultivating Collections exhibition, Julie Armbruster and Brooke Pretty Conrad. So Julie Armbruster is an Asheville-based artist who received her MA in studio art from New York University in 2003 and her BS in art education from the State University of New York at New Paltz in 2001. She studied in Venice, Italy for 2 summers and was inspired by the Renaissance paintings she encountered there, particularly painted panels with continuous narrative. Her own work focuses on painted narratives that celebrate weirdness and idiosyncrasy through depictions of cartoonist figures in a colorful graphic style. Brooke Pretty Conrad is an Asheville-based artist who received her BFA in Fine Arts from the San Francisco Art Institute in 2000. She studied painting technique in China and apprenticed in fashion in New York City. Heavily inspired by sculpture and performance art, she pursued textiles and clothing design. She founded her own clothing line, Ship to Shore Clothier, specializing in handmade one-of-a-kind ceremonial garments and gowns. While dressmaking has become her primary practice, she continues to cultivate her performance art in collaborations with fellow artists in a variety of mediums. So we're excited to have you here, Brooke and Julie. Thank you so much for being a part of our conversation. And I'm going to kick off the Q&A with a question that I'm really excited about is, could you tell us a little bit about the art that you focus on and how did you to be collaborators. And I'm really interested in learning how you became collaborators, because I personally own work by both of you. And Brooke, you designed my wedding gown that I wore when we got married. And then Julie, I commissioned you to create our family portrait last year, which we're very excited about, not knowing that you two had been collaborating for the last 10 years. So I'm personally attracted to your aesthetic, not even knowing that you're collaborators. So, can you talk a little bit about your work individually and then how you became collaborators? So we'll start with Julie. Tell us a little bit about your work.
Hi, Denise. Thank you. Well, you know, I went to school for painting, my master's degree, and then after I finished that, I ended up moving to Asheville to join the AmeriCorps. And while I was here, I was checking out a lot of different artist studios, and mostly I was working with nonprofits, so I was doing a lot of community type things, and I just decided that this was a great place to open a studio. And I've been working in the same studio since 2009 at the Wedge Brewery building, the Wedge Studios. And my process is based purely on automatic drawing. So I will just let the painting tell me what they need, and I will bring it out of the panel that way. And so I've been doing stuff around Asheville since opening the studio in 2009, and it's been going really well, so I feel very lucky.
Great. And so from your perspective, Julie, how did you come to meet Brooke, and when did you decide to become collaborators?
When I first moved here, I knew that I wanted to start an art collective. I had studied them in New York and read books about different intentional communities, and I just knew that had to happen. So as soon as I moved here, I started meeting people, and I was introduced to Brooke through a friend, and she just had this like wonderful enthusiasm for homework that I hadn't found anywhere else. Like, all of the other people that I worked with were like not into rules. They definitely didn't like being pushed into any direction, and Brooke was like, I love homework, I love special projects, I can't wait to like do something with you and make it better than we could have possibly imagined. So she was a natural win for me. I'm really glad to have met her, and we got along really well from the beginning. So that was
That's great. Well, and so right above me over here is our family portrait. You really can't, you can only see the tail end of it, but we're delighted to have that, Julie. I think that really speaks to your work. One of the things we were excited about in having a family portrait done was not, a photocopy of our family, but really bringing out like the character traits in all of us. And I think your work does that just across the board, you know, certainly in our family portrait, but your characters are just full of life and personality, and that's what's really exciting, I feel, about your work. Look, tell us a little about your work, and from your perspective, why did you start to collaborate with Julie, and what were you excited about there?
Thank you, Denise. Thanks for that introduction. It's really nice to be here. I moved to Asheville to be nearer to my family and to start my business in early 2000s. And I chose to build my career around dressmaking and making one-of-a-kind garments custom for clients, mostly bridal gowns, as you know. It was an honor to make yours. But I still kept up my personal creative practice in fine arts and managed to acquire shows at some pretty great galleries and continue to do my drawing practice in my own time and do performance art and sculpture. And through that, I met Julie. I got invited to a drawing club meeting. This was before Newsworthy was founded. Julie was involved in a different club. And the meeting was at her place in her studio. And it became apparent to me really quickly that Julie and I would be great collaborators and longtime friends. We both had a similar enthusiasm for collaboration. And we had a really good rapport. It was really clear that we could both have our personal creative voices raised up, and like a beautiful collaboration was entirely possible. So we founded this club together and started meeting on a weekly basis and maintaining our creative practice as a collaborative force for many, many years.
That is so exciting. And when I think about your work, you know, in relation to Julie's, you know, I see some of the similar characteristics as, you know, working with you to build the my beautiful, you know, wedding gown that was built off the foundation of my mother's wedding gown. You really create a whole personality to that dress. And again, you know, similar to Julie's work, you really tease out the character in each piece, and everything is totally unique and different. And, you know, when you're wearing a gown, I just felt like it had so much personality and so much of me in that. So that, I think that might be what I'm personally drawn to in both of your work, is that each of you really infuse all of your work with independent personality in each object that you create. So that's really exciting. I am going to turn this over to Carolyn now, who is the curator of the Cultivating Collections exhibition series, and she can speak a little bit more about the work that your collaborative work that we're including in the exhibition.
Hey, Brooke and Julie. So excited to have you here. This is great, bringing you together for a virtual conversation. If we haven't rolled the image of Denise's wedding dress and the portrait by Julie, can we do that? So I have a few questions before we take questions from social media. And I teach an exhibition practicum class here at Western Carolina University. And my students have been the ones researching the paintings, some of the drawings in the museum's collection. And one of my students, Christina Colomb, was initially interested in the works by Julie and Brooke in the collection. And Tina had reached out to Julie to visit her studio and do an interview. And one of the really fascinating parts about the interview was sort of your discussion about the Newsworthy Drawing Club. So I'm wondering if you could tell us a little bit more about the Newsworthy Drawing Club and why you chose this format for producing artwork. So Julie, you want to start us off?
Sure. Before Newsworthy, we were in a more loose-based drawing club where we come up with things kind of haphazardly, and it wasn't organized enough to feel like there was momentum. When Brooke and I started with the Newsworthy, it had a very specific outline of what the meetings would be like, and it just gave you this like ability to like fully embrace the process, as opposed to what are we going to paint? You know, like a lot of artists have the trouble of what are you going to paint? You know, the blank canvas, where this had none of that stress, and it was purely about being in that particular club at the moment and allowing yourself to figure out what you could pull out of the article that you related to, or that you connected to, or that you thought would be interesting. And so the imagery was a very natural process. And we had limited timelines because both of us had really intense regular art jobs. And so it was a very specific practice that helped us really like focus on that one project each. So should we say how it starts, the process of the Newsworthy Drawing Club? I can start with that if you want.
Yeah, let's hear about the process a little bit. You know, about the news articles.
Yeah. So we would meet at either of our studios, and we had clipboards, 8x8-inch watercolor paper, and a little watercolor set, and a mechanical pencil with an eraser. And that was just it. So just simplify everything so that it can actually happen was a definite plus of this club. You can get just very distracted and into your own thing too much. So This was the way that we could make that happen. And I would find a news article online or in a newspaper that I thought would be an interesting illustration. And Brooke would find one also. So our first collaboration is we would switch articles. So I would find one, she would find one, and then we'd switch at the beginning of the meeting. And then we'd free draw based on the text. And after about an hour of free drawing, we would switch again. And I would finish hers, and she would finish mine. And you know, it ended up being like a 2-hour thing every week. So it was a great process, I thought.
Yeah, we came up with the idea of doing news articles as like a functional container for how can we make the most out of this experience of spending just this very short period of time together every week and come up with a body of work by the end of the year that is really cohesive, tells a story, is like a capsule of the time. And I feel like it helped us direct our time in like a really productive and fun way. So collaboration in general is like a real exercise in trust. And we both have that trust in one another. We just had the ability to draw on the page and then pass it without any sort of like preconceived notions or demands for one another. We just let ourselves be free. And that is a really precious and unusual thing between two artists, and I'm really thankful for it. But we would make a strong point of not referencing, like we would bring in these articles cold. She wouldn't know what I was bringing, and I wouldn't know what she was bringing. And we'd sit and we'd absorb them and read and then not refer to any imagery. So we'd cut out the picture from the news article. We would not look online. So if the article was about a man that smuggles like exotic animals onto an airplane, then we wouldn't have a picture of the man or the animals, or we would just freeform create this. And it was our way of having a container for our time together that would produce a body of work that could be bound together and presented as an entire piece that year.
Yeah, that's great. And we're so excited that you have this body of work. So one of the things that I always tell my students is that when you're researching artwork in a museum's collection, one of the really important parts of that process is to try to find out about the artist, find out about the context for the artwork. But what's really important too is to find details and stories about the specific works that are in the museum's collection. So I'm hoping you can tell us a little bit about the four works that we have in the museum's collection. We have some images that we can show of those. What news articles inspired these works? And what drew you to these particular stories? And then I'm also curious about what contributions you both made to the work. So, you know, what part of the works are sort of Brooke and what part of the works are Julie?
Well, I can speak to the article selection. In the very beginning days of our club, we would just choose any article that seemed interesting or like it told an interesting story. And what we ended up having was like too broad of subject matter. And the things that we were really drawn to and we found that we were really good at were animal related things. So what you'll see in all the pieces you have in your collection here, they're all animal based. And that's something that Julie really shines at, is doing characters of creatures. And we both play to our strengths. I really like doing watercolor. I like doing pen and ink. And Julie's really good at doing very expressive characters that are like humorous and endearing and tell big stories. And so we both would lean on the things that we know that we shine at. So often I would be doing the outlining and the watercolor, and Julie would be doing the like gestural, the drawing of the faces and the bodies.
Yeah, Julie, did you have thoughts on the specific works that we have in the collection?
I think it's true. The animal-based ones were the better successes, which we learned over the years. The first book had a lot more extreme news, I guess, a little less lighthearted. And then the second book also had a similarly, like, a little bit more darkness to it. Then we figured out that a lot of our best works were science-based, like new science discoveries, any kind of animal-related, obviously, and then also strange, very strange things. And in addition to the side bend of the animal ones, it's usually animals like reacting to humans, so in a very like powerful way. So it's like animal rights, you know. It felt like a really important add to the whole drawing, which is very lighthearted and fun. So
yeah, that's great. Well, and you both have mentioned, you know, this kind of book that you've produced at the end of the year of, you know, some of these drawings that you made. So I'm curious about that too, because I think you've found some creative ways to share this work with the public. And, you know, there's also been kind of other artwork that has springboarded from, you know, this work that you did together. So can you talk about that a little bit, how you shared it with the public, you know, the books that you compiled at the end of the year, and, you know, maybe what other artworks may have come of it?
Brooke, you want to jump in?
Yeah, sure. So I've got a copy of Newsworthy of 2009 here in my hands. We, after our first year of creating all this content, neither of us are bookmakers, mind you, but we decided that we would endeavor to hand bind these books and limited editions of them and do what we called a year in review in a gallery setting. So our first show, Jules, correct me if I'm wrong, was it at Bobo?
Yes,
it
was.
Downtown on
North Lexington.
Like North Lexington, the Bobo Music and Art Gallery in the bar. And we debuted our books. I think we had an edition of, what do you think, like 15 or 20 of them?
We eventually got to 30, you know, kind of like reminiscent of the 30 days in the month. But the first one, it was a lot of crunch. The timeline was crunched. And they're all inlaid plates with double stick tape. Old-fashioned books, and yeah, we had nothing about page maker or any of that. It was all about Photoshop.
We felt so great and cavalier to take on this project, and we did have friends that were bookbinders that could give us advice and help us with this, but we were just very brave, and we thought that this would be a fun project, and it was extremely difficult, but we managed to hand bind and produce a lot of these pieces and also collaborate with other artists. We love to work with musicians that we would invite them to create an original song based on one of the articles from the book. We would give them the book and let them choose. And we were very lucky to work with some really talented musicians. So at this show, the opening at Bobo, there was two bands that played.
I think it was just King Tut, and we didn't ask them. That was the first year's kind of trial run. But every year thereafter, we asked them to write a song based on an article, which we would send them way in advance. And they probably didn't even see the drawings until the show.
Right.
And I think we have a clip, I think, of one of the songs that was produced in response to the merry-go-round image that's in the museum.
Yes. sound of what comes around. Ignoring every consequence. Because the kids are all crazy. They've got that look in their eye. Spinning and spinning and spinning out of control.
Yeah, so I'm so excited that we have this song that goes along with it.
It's so great to collaborate in so many different ways. I think that's the real spirit of this work, is the idea of collaboration.
And being
That song was by Old Flings.
That was Matt Evans. That was his personal work. He wrote the song, and then he has a punk band that he played. They made a more band version of it, but yeah.
Okay, cool. So it's actually had a few different iterations. So we have some questions coming in from social media. So we're going to start to take some of those.
Yes. Yeah, this is really exciting, you guys. We've got some questions coming in. So this first question is from Christina Colomb. Who was our student who worked with you, Julie, to interview you for the exhibition. Christina writes, with each piece that you created, do you save the newspaper articles with each piece?
Yeah, the binders. Binders, the many, many binders. We got them all here. It's all like, it's all archived.
Awesome. So Christina, there's your answer. Lots of binders. Our next question is from Sarah Rincon. Do you think the Newsworthy Drawing Club has affected your other creative pursuits or other collaborative relationships?
I'm going to say absolutely. I feel like the more time you spend sharing your voice and creating something together with someone else, working together on a mutual goal, it just strengthens your ability to be able to communicate and collaborate with other artists. We honed our skills together in that way. And I carried that skill over to my dressmaking career. As Denise described, all the projects that I do with dressmaking are collaborations. I'm working with my client and their heirloom materials in order to create something that brings them joy and makes them feel beautiful, and in the similar way that Julie and I would collaborate on creating a work together. So yeah, I'd say it definitely led into other avenues in my life.
And you, Julie?
Yeah, I feel the same. Besides improving each year with Brooke and then finding more articles that we knew would help highlight her talent, which was very like repetitive design. All of that was just, any of that in the drawings is definitely all her. But I did find myself getting stronger as a as an artist, just hanging out with her once a week. Her ability and her draftsmanship is better than anyone I've worked with. So it was very impressive, and it helped raise me up also.
Opportunity to see someone else or be involved in someone else's creative process in that way. Like we were creating the work in person in front of one another during that capsule of time, like 2 hours a week. And so you get to see how they do their marks and like how the image comes in, how it comes to life. And that's a really unusual opportunity. Most people don't get to experience that from another artist's practice.
It sounds like you guys have a really strong collaboration. That's awesome. We've got some other comments coming in. We've got a comment from Jennifer Hawkins Hawk. She says, very interesting to hear how the news inspired Julie and Brooke's creative collaborations. Cool multisensory work, bouncing creativity off artists from other genres. So that's a great comment. Thank you, Jennifer, for posting that in there. I have a question for both of you, actually, and this is something we've been asking our artists who've been joining us for these virtual programs. And it's for both of you, and I'll have Brooke answer it first, but what kind of art projects are you working on in quarantine? And I pose that question to Brooke because I've seen a couple of your collaborations on Facebook, quarantine collaborations.
Yeah, I've been working on, I started the quarantine by putting my sewing machines to use. And a dear friend of mine who works for the ASPCA in New York, they have a whole lot of essential workers that are keeping their shelters up and running even during the shutdown. And so we made over 150 fabric masks for their essential workers. So that kept me really busy. But after my son went to bed at night, I would work on this dollhouse. Julie's masks are there. These pictures that you're seeing now are details from a dollhouse that I've been building, which is a replica of my own home. And I'm making miniature, this is a very meticulous project that requires a lot of time being stuck inside, and that became the name of a short video series that we have been making. I'm making this in collaboration with my sweetheart, Peter Lutz. We take just an iPhone camera and film short videos, no more than 30 seconds to a minute long, of him sticking his head into these rooms in my dollhouse and kind of describing the emotions and the feelings of what it is to be quarantined and how big and overwhelming his body is in these tiny little sets. Like the images that you're seeing right now, the rooms are no more than like 8 by 8 inches. And so you can almost fit your head completely in there. And we come up with some interesting tricks and ways to express how it feels to be stuck inside. And that's been my primary work during this quarantine.
Awesome. And Julie, what have you been up to in quarantine?
Well, my daughter was in kindergarten when the quarantine started, and you know, she was doing great, so we didn't want to lose any of that. And I became one of two homeschool teachers, virtual teachers. So that was a great deal of time. Great deal of time. She's learning to read and all of that. So we set up a classroom at the house, and we made sure to do all of the specials. You know, the specials were the most important, obviously. And I also made masks for my family and my friends, and there we are, sporting our masks. It was, you know, I'm not really great at sewing. I definitely am inspired by Brooke, so I definitely just jump right in and see where it goes. This is a project that I had started before the quarantine, where I am recreating a painting that I made for an album. And I'm recreating it in plush, mostly hand sewing, but a little bit of machine sewing. And It is like you can see that I just cut out the pieces sort of like a collage, and then as it's getting built, I figure out how to put it together. It's amazing that it comes out good, is my opinion on that. But I love them. And I also was encouraged to do the artist support pledge online, which I thought was a wonderful idea. It was a British artist who encouraged other artists to sell things for $200 or less, and once they reached $1,000 in sales, to buy another artist's work for $200 to reinvest in the community and to get people feeling less scared that everything's shut down and there's no future. So we definitely tried to not have that feeling. I also did two special request portraits, one in the Lunch Buddy series like Denise's. This is a wonderful family, actually, towards the last week I was painting this, their dog died. And so we had to figure out a way to include the dog. You know, it's just similarly to any kind of collaboration. You just have to go back and forth and make it work. And ultimately with the human portraits, I want them to love it, and I will not stop until that happens. So it's a huge ask, but I love it and they love it. And so that was really fun.
Oh yeah, those portraits are amazing. And for those of you who don't know, when you commission Julie to do a portrait, she saves all of the bits and pieces about your family and the sketches and puts them in a nice little envelope behind the painting. So behind this painting are all of the notes that she captured. And that just makes it even more meaningful, Julie. They're incredible. So we've got some more comments and questions coming in. Questions from our WCU Friends of the Arts group. Does the Newsworthy Drawing Club still meet?
We're on hiatus currently. Both of us became parents around the same time. And I had imagined it very differently for my free time, but we're working on it. You know, my daughter's 5. She just turned 6. Brooke's son is a similar age, a little younger. And it requires a whole different level of time. But hopefully we can get back to it. I would love to work with her again.
We're talking about meeting up today, and maybe we'll bring an article.
That's true.
Awesome. One more question from social media, and then we'll go back to Carolyn's questions. This is coming to us from Phyllis Green. Was there a favorite piece that you two created together?
I have a favorite. So Brooke had drawn this one. It was called Family of 8 Rides Moped Together. It's amazing, amazing drawing. And as we were getting our work prepared for the end of the year show, we would make supplementary work that was much larger in scale to kind of fill out the gallery and get people like excited about looking at books, which was
and
very-
And Julie, we have a picture of that one.
Oh, cool.
We'll put a picture of it.
The rest of our shows, after the Bobo's gallery, we had them all at Harvest Records, which is a very overwhelming space. And to get people to focus on the art show and not the records and CDs and all the cool stuff that they have there for sale, you have to kind of draw them in with something large. Anyhow, so part of my favorite one is where we took news articles from that year and then inserted them into the composition of the Family of 8 Rides Moped Together. So it was a variety of news articles put into that composition, and it came out amazing. I love it so much. And it's huge. The painting was huge.
Yeah, and Brooke, do you have a favorite?
You can, we put in some of the different articles that showed up in it. It was fun to just go through the drawing and sort of identify, you know, the different characters and feature articles in it.
I do have a favorite. Thanks for asking. I mentioned it earlier. It's one that I personally really love. It's called Bird Smuggler. And I don't know if you can see this. I mentioned it before. It's about a man who endeavored to smuggle songbirds into the United States to sell them. And he made special socks and put the little birds in the socks before he boarded the plane. And he got arrested at LA International Airport. But this is one of my favorite drawings of ours. I think it really shows both of us in a beautiful way.
So Carolyn, back to questions from you, and then we'll go back to social media.
Okay, yeah, I have a couple of questions. So I'm curious about if, you know, as you're looking at these news articles or reading news articles and then translating that into some sort of images, some sort of image, and you've done this for a long time. So I'm wondering if your drawings and paintings ever sort of change the way that you thought about the news? Did they impact the way you thought about the news, or did you ever think that your works were a comment commentary on the news in any way?
You know, I think we really made the conscious decision to veer away from painful, difficult subjects and politics, anything that was, we decided, made the conscious decision to focus on things that were playful and bring levity into our lives and spend those 2 hours focusing on stories that were like strange, unusual, macabre, sometimes sweet. That's mostly why we chose animals as our focus as well. It was something that we were both craving in our lives, and it was like instead of doing a meditation practice together, we were doing just a playful collaboration about subject matters that were light and silly even.
So, and we do have a question coming in from School of Art and Design asking, do you consider your collaborative work illustration?
I definitely think it's illustrative, and it is illustrating a news article. It makes sense to say that, yes. Illustration.
We took liberties, you know, we were very playful with our way of depicting these characters, knowing that we weren't basing it on what the actual characters really looked like, you know, because most of these articles would have a photograph of the people that the article was about or the actual animal. And we made the choice to use our imagination to create these characters rather than base it directly on who they were. So yes, they're illustrative, but they're from our imagination.
Yeah. And I have one final question for you too. And this just kind of brings it back full circle to my exhibition practicum class. I know that, you know, when Christina interviewed you, Julie, she really enjoyed connecting with another artist. And so I wonder if the two of you have any advice for our art students at Western who are, you know, emerging artists and just starting out. Do you have any advice for them?
I definitely always, when people ask me my advice about art, is to create a life for yourself that incorporates studio time, and that to get better, you have to spend a lot of time at it. It's not, you may have gifts coming in, but that's not enough to continue and consider it your life's work. So carving out a life where you can have a lot of the most possible studio time is the best advice I can send.
I agree with that. And I would add one more thing. Julie and I made the conscious decision in the formation of this club to not base our choices on profitability. And I think that's really difficult sometimes when you approach your studio practice, if you want to make a career as an artist, to not be constantly considering what's sellable. And I think it's a really beautiful thing to be able to enter a space and not have to craft a capitalistic undertone to your art making. So we let ourselves off the hook with that. And we were lucky to actually make enough income from the sales of the books to keep the club open. But it was purely for fun and for play. And I think that that's an important thing to throw into the mix when you're wanting to develop a career around the arts, is to give yourself the opportunity to not make everything, all your decisions based on profit and sales.
Also to highlight the collaboration, after you finish school, you know, you're on your own. To find a community or even just one person to make sure that you connect with about art and not to feel so alone and to bounce ideas about, you know, what things that you want to work on, it's important to maintain that community, and that's not usually a given unless you join an artist compound or something, but to make the effort not only to have studio practice, but to also integrate community, like artists into your community so that you can grow.
Well, thank you so much. I appreciate you giving some advice to our emerging artists at Western and also for being on this program today. We really appreciate it.
Thank you. It's been a great opportunity for us.
So Denise, I'll turn it back to you.
I want to second Carolyn. Thank you both for joining us. And I think that's a great note to end on, you know, making sure that we still connect with our communities, even during this time when most of us are staying at home and not forgetting to play and have fun with what you do. I hope that these virtual public programs offer a little bit of fun and playfulness in our viewers' days, and that we add to that creative community and just inspiring folks while they're staying at home during this time. So that's a wonderful note to end on. So thank you so much, Julie and Brooke, for being on the call. For those of you who are interested in seeing this work, I do want to mention that the Cultivating Collection exhibition will be on view virtually this fall. So stay tuned to our website. While we're still unsure of our physical reopening date, this exhibition will be able to be viewed in a 360 format. And we hope to continue these public programs that feature artists from the Cultivating Collections series of exhibitions throughout the fall. I also want to thank all of you who chimed in on social media. Thank you so much for joining us and sharing your questions with the group. And I also, again, want to thank Ray Griffin and Tom Robinson for their contribution that made this work, you know, come to the WCU Fine Art Museum collection. So we're really appreciative of that. Ray and Tom, thank you. I miss seeing all of you in person at the Bardo Art Center and the WCU Fine Art Museum, and we hope to see you soon. But until then, we'll keep tuning in to see you on these virtual public programs. So stay tuned to our website, our Facebook, and our YouTube for more information. So again, thank you so much for joining us, and have a wonderful day.